Okay, we're ready to start again this second slot. I appreciate the ones that are still around for this actually very exciting part of this session. We're going to start immediately with a presentation by Skipper, or Skipper, you tell me. But what are submarine power class trying to tell us? And this is what they've been asking Ian for quite a long. So I'll give the stage.
All right, thank you very much. The topic of today's presentation is what are submarine power class trying to tell us? Because it's hard to talk underwater. And so if we have a column of water over top of our volcanic vent, that will affect the eruption in several ways. And we can basically divide the effects into two sort of general types of effects. The first is by having elevated hydrostatic pressure, which is going to influence degassing dynamics. And the second type of effect is due to having the presence of this all this water around your vent. And that will affect eruptions in myriad ways, including particle quenching, transport and dispersal dynamics, and fragmentation mechanisms. Now, for today, there's a lot of different ways, different things submarine power class are trying to tell us, but I'm going to focus on the second group of just a few examples of the second group of effects, looking at power class from Surtsey in the eruption of 63 to 67, Iceland, a few examples from Louis-He Seamount, some experiments, and of course making reference to the only two observed submarine explosive eruptions from Northwest Rota 1 and West Mata. So quenching is very important, because if we want to know about explosive eruptions, the process that differentiates an effusive from an explosive eruption essentially is fragmentation. So we want to know what the fragmentation surface looks like in terms of vesicle textures and magma permeability and all these interesting parameters. And this is a problem if you're studying subaerial eruptions. We've got post-fragmentation evolution of pyroclasts. And this is obvious if you just look at a picture of a typical Strombolian burst or Hawaiian fire fountain. They're red. So you can see these pyroclasts are hot. They're continuing to evolve in the plume. Now, I will draw your attention to the pyroclasts around the margins of that Hawaiian plume there. Wendy Stovall and others, 2010, did a good job of pinpointing which textures in the melange of textures in Hawaiian lapilli that best represented the fragmentation surface. But in the submarine environment, this is much easier because of rapid quenching right at the vent. And so Marcel Patuzak, Alex Nichols, and others working out of Munich have shown that some submarine glasses are among the fastest quenched natural materials known, using differential scanning calorimetry. But even at a less technical level, if you just look at the plumes, this is Northwest Rota 1 on the left and Home Reef Tonga on the right, a shallower example, they're black. The pyroclasts are getting quenched much quicker than they are in the subaerial environment. So if we go to Surtsey in Iceland and look at some of the textures in the pyroclasts, we find that they're dominantly microlite-free ground mass, sideromeline ground mass, and nice scoriaceous bubble textures. We also find over there on the right bubble number densities and porosity. Porosity is reasonably low, 30 to 40%, and in a fairly narrow range. Now, this is good news if you're modeling conduit ascent and dynamics and things like this, because it starts to suggest that the fragmentation surface in these basaltic eruptions is actually more homogeneous than the textures in Hawaiian fire fountain samples might suggest. So the blue field is data from Stovall and others. Ah, great. The blue field is data from Stovall et others, and with a much wider range of porosity and a bit of a wider range in number density, reflecting the different thermal history of different class derived from different parts of the jet. Now, in Surtsey, we don't have that. We've got this tighter range, and we can start to quantify using things like the program of Wim de Gruyter and others. We can start to take a look at what permeability, perhaps a more interesting parameter, looked like at the fragmentation surface. Now, that's not to say that the fragmentation surface is a simple place, because we do have a subset of pyroclasts in Surtsey that are very different, with much lower permeability, very high ground mass crystallinity and are very dense. And so it's not entirely simple for modeling the fragmentation surface, but the nice thing that the submarine pyroclasts are trying to tell us is that they're inviting us to have a look at the fragmentation surface so that we don't have to sort out which of these happened in the plume and which happened up on the way to the fragmentation surface, because they all did. Okay, so it does get a little more complicated, though, when we start looking at transport and dispersal, because water is denser, more viscous than air, and therefore will modify a submarine plume in many different ways. This could examples could be hydrodynamic sorting, or a nice new paper by, Barriere and others, 2011, about the entrainment of small particles into thermal submarine plumes. And it can be can influence particle recycling. Now, in analysis of the videos by Deerdorf and others 2011, or Clegg and others at Lao Basin, they've found that a significant proportion of the pyroclasts are recycled back into the vent. Now, going back to CERTSI examples again, we see evidence for this. So we had these two textural types, and even in a very small lapilli, no scale bar here, but this is just a 3 millimeter lapilli. We've got entrainment of tachylite domains into sideromeline hosts. And we know that this is entrainment if we look closer at the boundaries between them. So here we've got a tachylite, obviously very different grain, entrained in a sideromeline host that's actually caused some chilling, quenching crystallization along the margin. So this class existed as a separate entity when it was entrained in this magma. Another example of recycling can be found, and this is possibly more important. If we start to look in the outsized vesicles, start to look inside the larger vesicles in the CERT sand class, whether in the dominant sideromeline population or voids, as you see in this tachylite grain, we see a whole bunch of rubbish in there. We see a whole bunch of ash particles. And when we were first seeing these in thin section, thought maybe it was a problem with thin section production, but I'm seeing these on tomographic scans in deep inside class that have never been cut. So these are picking up a melange of material from in the vent. And what's kind of a giveaway here is that the ash inside there, it's morphologically similar to the juvenile ash, and it's also of multiple populations itself. So that within a class that's entirely sideromeline, you have ash that is both tachylite and sideromeline inside, and vice versa. So this the melt that erupted was entraining material that was a slurry in the vent. So this is a bit of a complicating process. And so that leads me into the second thing that submarine pyroclasts are trying to tell us, which is that volcanoes are dirty places. So, and this leads actually right into the third thing too. If we take a look at this ash, same two images at the top, and we go into the lab. So this is some experiments we did a couple years ago, just out earlier in 2011 with colleagues at Würzburg. Very simple experiments. We just poured some liquid magma into a bucket of dirty water, a mixture of different mixtures of pumice and clay and mud. And what we found was, even though we're pouring a completely degassed magma with it's not vesiculating due to magmatic volatiles, the results are almost scoriaceous looking. These are vesicular particles produced during these experiments, except for the vesicles are lined entirely with sediment. So it's the some sort of hydrodynamic mingling process in which the melt has entrapped part of this slurry from in the bucket. So these bubbles are bubbles, and they look very much like vesicles, but they have nothing to do with magmatic degassing. So this is starting to be a little bit of a complicated story. And now I would be remiss if I didn't talk about Limu Opele. I love Limu Opele. They're the beautiful and talented small glass shards that are originally described from the coastline of Kilauea, where a lava flow entraps water and vaporizes it to form these large isolated bubbles that burst, where you preserve these walls into the beautiful, delicate shapes. Those are Limu Opele fragments. And they're very common in deep sea volcaniclastic deposits. Now, their origin has been debated. Are they created by isolated bubbles bursting due to pyroclastic activity, bubbles driven by exsolved magmatic volatiles bursting through a submarine vent, or do they have a hydroclastic origin, where a melt is entrapping external water and then vaporizing it to grow an isolated bubble? So we debated about this a little bit. which was fine until the observations at West Mata that really nailed the explosive origin of Limu'opele. So we had these beautiful bubble bursts. If you were here 2 years ago, this created quite a sensation, and rightly so. This is quite spectacular footage. And these bubble bursts created Limu'opele, driven by decoupled magmatic volatiles. And so that was very exciting. Also exciting is when you go into the lab and you turn your high-speed video camera on some melt poured into a bucket of water. You see here, this is vastly, vastly slowed down, so the whole process occurs in about a couple hundred milliseconds. But you see it creates a small flow at the bottom that entrains water. We really get a good look at this metastable vapor film on the outside of this expanding bubble until rupture and a slight implosion. There's no magmatic volatiles involved here. And the results are very interesting when you collect them from the bottom of the bucket, which is significantly easier than collecting them from the bottom of the ocean, but they look exactly the same. These are particles collected from Lauihi Seamount, Hawaii, and these are particles collected from the bottom of that bucket. So they're entirely the same. And this, along with that entrainment in the dirty coolant experiments, sort of sum up the third thing that I wanted to point out that submarine pyroclasts are trying to tell us. And that is simply that there's more than one way to blow a bubble, especially when you're dealing with low viscosity basaltic melts. And so just to sum up, some of the few things, there are a much, much longer list. Didn't even touch on degassing dynamics, but just this afternoon, what are submarine pyroclasts trying to tell us? They're inviting us to have a look at the fragmentation surface, but they're saying be careful, because volcanoes are dirty places where we can expect to have interaction with erupting magma, and not just water, but slurries and anything that's around, and there's more than one way to blow a bubble. That's it.
Thank you, Ian, for this nice presentation. It looks really that we are talking different languages with pyroclasts, and we need a very nice vocabulary to understand them. So there is any question? Can't see anybody? Question?
Can you think of a way... Yeah. Can you think of a way to distinguish whether a bubble was filled with magmatic gas or whether that was entrained gas?
No. briefly, no. I mean, I would hope that actually, this is not my area of expertise, but I would hope that perhaps there could be some sort of contaminant signature on one side of, say, a Limu shard, indicating that it had interacted with seawater, perhaps a chlorine contamination or something of the sort. That's possible. One thing that is obvious in the video from the Limu formation in the lab is that this vapor film is a very important part of the interaction, right? The moment we lose that vapor film, we lose our bubble. It quenches immediately. And so the inside surface of that bubble as well is going to be hot and then going to have a vapor film as well. And so there's got to be some sort of chemical exchange or something if we're dealing with seawater versus magmatic water. But it'll be some sort of isotope or something.
can I ask it?
Okay, thank you.
Yep. Just one. So what do the pyroclasts created at the fragmentation surface look like?
Which fragmentation surface?
In these submarine ones, right? You're saying we have a chance to look at the fragmentation surface more clearly or cleanly than in a subaerial eruption, which is great. So just after this, you've put some complexity on, so I'm interested.
Yes.
What are the ideal pyroclasts created right at the magmatic fragmentation surface look like?
Right. Well, that's difficult, right? So we have to look at each pyroclast and account for these other possible effects, right? So... in the CERTSI class we're looking at right now, they put up the data, they're plotting in a nice tight region, and that's very encouraging. But the next step in that is going to be to take a closer look and see if we actually need to, like, for example, in a porosity or a number density calculation, see if it's more appropriate to actually remove those large bubbles with the ash inside and see if we, in fact, need to do this. I mean, so they allow us to look at the fragmentation surface, but when we look there, we see these different levels of complexity that are not the same levels of complexity that typically need to be applied when studying a subaerial eruption, right? So you can eliminate your, well, to a degree, eliminate your post-fragmentation expansion, but we need to incorporate these other things. The nice thing is that there's textural evidence for them in most cases. I don't know, still a work in progress.
All right, thank you. We're moving on to the next talk by Portner and Clegg, categorizing vitreous lithofacies on seamounts, implications for recognizing deep marine pyroclastic deposits. And we're all nearly set. There's water for you. There's the thing.
Yeah. Oh. Hello. Some bright lights there. Thanks for sticking around here towards the end of the conference. I'm going to continue on now sort of what Ian was just talking about, and that's these deep marine pyroclastic deposits on the seafloor. So what we really want to do is sort of take a step back now and look at the range in volcaniclastic rocks that we get on the deep sea in the hopes of being able to better identify them on the seafloor. And this will hopefully give us a better idea of the transport mechanisms, maybe some insight on the deeper eruption processes, and also see if there's a link to perhaps caldera formation, at least on our study sites. So the study sites that we chose are basically offshore here. The tops, these are all seamounts that have morb compositions. There's a chain just off here to the west of us, the Taney seamounts. The tops of them are about 2.5 kilometers deep. They're a lot older. They're about 30 million years old. The other seamount chains, including axial seamount, which is sort of our modern analog, the tops of them are about 1.5 kilometers deep. And they're all less than 5 million years old, still active. So M'Bari has quite a capability to get down there at those depths. And over the last decade or so, there's about 25 ROV dives on these seamounts. And a huge database of samples, 60 of which are volcaniclastic in origin. I think we can delineate about 7 distinct lithofacies from these samples using a criteria as we might do on land. And that is, what are the grain compositions, the componentry, the granulometry, the texture and fabric of the rocks, the heterogeneity of glassy class within a single sample, as well as what sort of landforms are they associated with on the seamount. And so just to get to the lithofacies, and I'll go through them from coarsest to finest, the first two are rather straightforward, the first being a polymict breccia. They're both breccias, so they're poorly sorted basalt fragments, angular glass fragments. The first one being polymict, in that it has a diverse range in chemistry, shown here in these blue squares, if you could see that. One sample has about the range in chemistry that you find on the whole seamount. And this one sample, at least, we're using this one seamount on Vance as a like our go-to seamount, I guess you could say. It's essentially sampling the entire caldera wall or a whole seamount chain, and sort of a talus pile right at the bottom of the ring fault surrounding our caldera. The other face is the monomict breccia. We generally find it surrounding these small cones, sort of a talus rampart as well. And the chemistry of these lithofacies is much more constrained, shown here in these pink and red squares. They have about the same range and composition of what you would get by chipping glass from a single basalt sample, shown here in these green circles sampled from the top of the seamount. And now these things are coarse grain. They likely didn't go very far in this environment anyway, so they probably were transported through debris avalanche and grain flows. There's really no sedimentary structures to see any other transport mechanisms. So the next lithofacies is vesicular lapilli tuff. Really only found it in one spot here on Taney A. It can be highly vesicular, up to perhaps 45% in vesicles is sort of a qualitative assessment. There's also dense class in there. There's basalt lithics, diabase lithics. And we're right up here on top of this dome-like structure on the seamount, which to me suggests that we're in a very proximal setting. And this stuff is also moving probably by short-lived proximal grain flows. And now the presence of these vesicles, is that telling us that there's a significant degassing that could hence fragment our magma? So the next lithofacies is Elimopele tuff, and I guess this is the lithofacies we often think of now on top of these seamounts. And you know, it has been studied quite extensively, I guess, over the last couple decades. And just to use some samples from axial seamount, sort of an analog, as the name implies, there's abundance of Limopele. There's also a highly vesicular class, as well as some dense angular fragments, as well as some of these hydrothermal grains. There's pyrite. There's some white mineral here. I'm not really sure what this is yet. I need to figure that out. But it has pyrite crystals embedded in it, as well as small glass fragments embedded in this white material as well. You find this white material cross-cutting these basalt lithic fragments. It's probably some type of anhydrite material. Now, when we look at the componentry of some of this stuff from axial, what we see, at least from these cores, is that in the corset's fraction, we get our Limopele. So here is greater than 1 millimeter. We get up to about 85% limo in this fraction. Now, so when we start to get to the finer grain fractions, we get more angular fragments, as well as lithics, biogenics, etc. So really, depending on where you are proximal to your source, you might be selectively accumulating different pyrite class or limo. And now we look at some of these samples as a whole, we see that essentially less than 10% of the samples have this coarse fraction. So you could think of, if you're going to point count or do a componentry analysis of the sample as a whole, you might be biased towards these more angular fragments or these other fragments. So this lithofacies can be thin-bedded, shown here on Vance seamounts as sort of these thin drapings on pillow basalt. It can be thicker as well. A core from axial just recently shows this nice normal grading from a core sash up into an ashy mudstone. You can see this ashy mudstone here in this section as these sort of inner beds, and I'll come back to that facies in a bit. Now look, the chemistry of this lithofacies is generally polymict. It can also be monomict, depending on what seamount you're on. You generally find it only on the seamount summits. A lot of the, basically many of these dives have done transects up the caldera walls, and we really don't find this lithofacies, you know, interbedded in the caldera walls. It's really only on top that we find it. Now, when we take a thin section and cut it perpendicular to bedding, we find a nice planar grain fabric, at least with the Limopele. And when we take a thin section and cut it parallel to bedding, we find more of a chaotic organization, or I guess lack of organization, at least of these elongate Limopele fragments. What you might expect is if we had a lateral flow, you might preferentially align these limu, like you might find, you generally find in turbidity current deposits. So as Ian was mentioning, there's a bit of, or has been, some debate on the fragmentation mechanisms. This is just some data from Hilo et al. This past year from axial seamount, and it shows that basically the larger circles have higher CO2 concentrations, and the red indicates that they're melt inclusions. So you can see that the melt inclusions have higher CO2 concentrations, and the host glass that their crystals are sitting in are much, they're fractionated and have a lot less CO2, and they suggested that this is this release of gas is what's causing the fragmentation. I also mentioned there's these hydrothermal minerals in there as well, so is that telling us something about maybe perhaps a hydrothermal fragmentation at some depth? Now the next lithofacies is sort of an oddball. It's a globular lapilli mudstone. So what does that mean? It's a mudstone. It's structureless. It has these thumbnail-sized lapilli of glass. It has these sort of fluidal morphologies that sort of interdigitate with the host mud. It also gets some Limopele branching off some of these lapilli as well. And you get some lemur just floating around in this mud as well. And you take a thin section of the stuff up close. This orange material is altered glass, the fresh glass being to the upper right. The sediment down here in the lower left sort of has a more, it's preserving a delicate sort of intermingling fabric with that glass. And to me, that's suggesting that this material, the magma was insulated, at least from being shattered like you might get if it was ballistically ejected into the water column. So maybe this is more of a hydrovolcanic fragmentation. And as Ian said, you know, you can blow bubbles in different ways. Are Limu even bubbles is another question I think that Christoph Hilo had a poster on today. So in any case, if we have a magma and we sort of inject it into a mud, we can then liquefy the mud and maybe create this more pebritic texture. The next lithofacies is an interesting one. It's this ashy mudstone. These photos are from Vance Seamount. It's generally composed of mineral fragments, typically plagioclase, pyroxene, some glass shards, which are generally devitrified, and also a lot of clay fragments. Interestingly, you get this quartz in here, and it's notable percentage at least, and even some epidote and some amphibole and a ton of other interesting minerals that you'd normally find in hydrothermal fault systems on mid-ocean ridges. And now when we look at the structures of this material, we see some nice planar laminations. It's got nice bedding. You even have some nice climbing ripples as well as some normal grading shown here in that photo. Now we generally find this facies going around the seamount, the caldera lips, I should say. And so is this suggesting to us that maybe it's associated with caldera formation and perhaps you'd have fluid focused along these ring faults and you could perhaps cause some sort of deeper hydrothermal fragmentation. And that might give us this abundance of mineral fragments fragmented from wall rock. The last lithofacies is sort of just a mishmash of stuff that you get everywhere. It's generally composed of biogenic fragments and small glass grains. It has a very diverse range in geochemistry, more so than anything else you find on a seamount. And to me, that's suggesting that this stuff can be carried very far away, perhaps through hydrothermal plumes, and just rain down through pelagic fallout. So to sort of wrap up now, this is just to give you an idea, where do we find our pyroclastic material? Well, it's really only on top of the seamount. Now, it's telling us something. So the sort of traditional or classical way, I guess, is that we shoal our seamount to shallow depths and we get above this fragmentation depth, and that's why we only find this material on top. Or is it that we have one sort of final caldera-forming eruption, and that's why we find it on top? And as we move our seamount away from our heat source, this is our final pulse, our last eruption. And I talked a little bit about transport mechanisms. So we go from more proximal grain flows to more distal fine suspension fallout, and perhaps through hydrothermal plumes. And I think that's something that I like to look in further. And so are there variations that we can see from more proximal, these monomic breccias or lapilli tufts, to these finer grain limulapilli tufts and ashy mudstones? And to be able to connect these two, I think, would be really, really helpful. And also, I showed some this strange mineralogy that you wouldn't expect to find, say, quartz on a seamount. So is this giving us an idea of maybe a deeper hydrothermal influence on fragmentation? So that's all I'd like to say. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Are there questions for Ryan? I guess everything was clear. Thank you very much. So the next talk is by Brittany Brand, Dufek, Mackeman, Jofland, and Pollock, integrating field and numerical techniques to understand the dynamics of pyroclastic density currents and the case example of Mount St. Helens.
All right. Thank you for sticking around for the afternoon session. Wow, it is really bright up here. Sunglasses, yeah, same name as sunglasses. All right, so today I'm going to be showing you some of the work that we've been doing for the last couple of years on the pyroclastic flow deposits at Mount St. Helens. So, should I just hit this here? Yeah. So I'd like to start just by running through a quick eruption summary. Most of you are familiar with this. The eruption began at 8:30 in the morning when the unstable flank of the volcano collapsed, resulting in the largest recorded landslide in history. This rapidly decompressed the cryptodome beneath the volcano, causing the lateral blast, which seared across the landscape, traveling 30 kilometers north of the volcano and basically devastating everything in its path. This then was followed by the early Plinian phase, so the morning was characterized by a typical Plinian eruption, and the afternoon was characterized by the collapse of the column and several phases of pyroclastic flows. So I'm going to be using pyroclastic flow today rather than pyroclastic density current, just because it's a lot faster to say. So I'd like to draw your attention here that because this was such an extremely well-observed eruption, for each of these periods throughout the day, we have great constraints on the mass flux of the eruption. And so the middle ash flow is some of the data I'll show you in this talk. We have a lot of initial conditions in terms of numerical modeling and modeling some of these flows because of this well-observed eruption. So the afternoon pyroclastic currents were much more localized than the lateral blast. They really were localized here about just 8 kilometers within the north of the volcano. So this DEM here shows the lateral extent of these. These areas that I've highlighted in yellow are the deposits of the debris avalanche that are cropping out today in the pumice plain. Some of them are buried in here as well. And you can also see that, so the pyroclastic flows came down all of the flanks here. Here's Spirit Lake, Johnson Ridge, and are really ponded in this area. And you can see that over 30 years of erosion has exposed, created extremely phenomenal exposures of these deposits and probably produced some of the best exposed pyroclastic flow deposits in the world. And so what we've been doing is trying to use the deposits to understand, for example, here you have very low surface roughness and you have flows that are spreading out across this plain, not interacting with topography, whereas over on this side of the pumice plain, you have high surface roughness and high interaction with topography. And so we can actually map out an individual flow unit across this entire pumice plain and deduce the influence of surface roughness on flow dynamics. So today I'm just going to show you a couple of things. We've been using the pyroclastic flow deposits to look at things like pumice rounding, which there's a poster on this morning, production of ash, things like that, elutriation of ash. Today I'm going to be talking more about the lithics in the flow, the accidental lithics, and channelization. So this first picture here is pretty proximal to source, 5 kilometers. And it's difficult to see, but there are a high percentage of accidental lithics in these deposits. And this is, if you trace this out in this direction with low surface roughness, you see that these lithics decrease in size and abundance with distance from source, which is what we expect. But if you look over to the northwest of the pumice plain here, where you have high surface roughness, you see that the proportion and size of these accidental lithics increase drastically. So the other thing that you notice in this area is that you have erosion into the, so this is these deposits here are from the middle pyroclastic flow sequence, and these are from the earlier one. So you have channelization and erosion into the underlying pyroclastic flow deposits with distance from source. And again, you see an increase in the abundance of these lithics. So the question is, the two questions I'll talk about today in the talk is, what are the source of these accidental lithics? Are they coming from the vent, or are they being derived locally? And how is that influencing flow dynamics if they're being derived locally? And also, what is causing the channelization in these flows, and how is that affecting overall flow dynamics? So the field methods are pretty standard stratigraphy mapping, but I wanted to highlight that we are also working with some guys from the University of San Luis Potosi who have come out and are employing their optical granulometry technique, which I won't get into much today, but here's a reference if you're interested. It's a really great technique which allows you to get detailed grain size distribution for outcrops that are fairly inaccessible, down to almost 2 millimeters in optimal conditions. You can also get grain fabric and things like that. So this is our first area located here, so the flow would have gone down around this area. So this first outcrop is what I consider my benchmark outcrop, because I'm pretty sure, given the field relationships, that the flow at this point when it was depositing was not interacting with any debris avalanche hummocks. So we can assume that the lithics that are being deposited here were coming from either vent erosion or somewhere down the steep flanks of the volcano. And so what I have a PhD student that's been doing very detailed componentry on these deposits. And we've linked these accidental lithics with the lithologies within the pre-edifice of the volcano. By the way, this is a helicopter for scale here. And this is the data that is derived from the optical granulometry technique. And so what we see is we can try to deduce where these are coming from. And so we have detailed geologic map of this stair step region on the steep flanks of the volcano. And you see that in this area where the flows would have been eroding, you have Castle Creek andesite, Pine Creek dacite, both lava flows and debris avalanche deposits. And you see that the lithics within the deposits, the pyroclastic deposits, are up to 75% of these lithologies. So this is consistent with previous estimates of up to 40 meters of erosion at this location by these pyroclastic flows. So now we're down here. So you see this is a debris avalanche hummock that's cropping out, and these are pyroclastic flow deposits just past it. This dark spot here, which is a little bit hard to see in the image, is blown up here. So you see a very large increase in the size and proportion of these lithics. And so we've done the same kind of componentry here, both taking the componentry of the debris avalanche hummock and this lithic lens. And here's the benchmark again for scale, or for reference. You see that the debris avalanche has a high proportion of this Kalama andesite, as does the lens downstream from this, relative to our benchmark. So we can say that a good proportion of these lithics are being derived locally. When we observe this, we see that once these flows start to erode into the debris avalanche hummocks and pick up the lithics, it promotes further erosion downstream. So it seems that the enhanced density gradient, or the enhanced bulk density at the base of the current, promotes erosion. And so downstream from this, you see both further erosion into the underlying pyroclastic deposits, as well as some channelization occurring as a result of this. Another interesting feature, though, is that we see channelization of these flows, or evidence for self-channelization of these flows, independent of interaction with these debris avalanche obstacles. So this, again, is the helicopter for scale. The flow direction is into the page here. And you have these beautiful levees, which are a little bit difficult to see in this picture, but these beautiful levees forming, suggesting that this is kind of the start of maybe a self-channelizing area of the flow. And if you trace this further downstream, you see you get much more pronounced channels being formed, and within these channels, the later flows that are filling them in, again coming from those middle ash flow phases, are carrying much larger blocks than earlier or previous more proximal deposits. So we can explore we have evidence for both entrainment of lithics locally, which gives us some insight into the erosive capacity of these currents, and it seems that when you erode into these hummocks and are picking up large lithics, that it's increasing the erosive capacity of the current and causing channelization, but we also see channelization independent of these obstacles. So now we can take a look and use some numerical methods to try to deduce what is the effect of erosion of the substrate and channelization on the overall flow dynamics. So Joe Dufek's models, and I won't go into a lot of detail because he's had several talks on these this week, but basically these are multi-phase numerical models that can model both the gas and the particles as separate phases, the interphase drag between the two, particle-particle interaction on the small scale within these different regions of the flow, as well as large-scale dynamics such as entrainment of air, interaction with obstacles, things like that. So this is just a first simulation down the steep flank here. And so it's showing that we can employ a three-dimensional topography in these models. So as you would expect, as the flow goes down, you see that you have parts of it that are actually channelized in these deep drainages, and you have other portions of the flow that are overtopping the drainage. And this is consistent with some of the deposits that we have just on the outside of these channels, which are these sand wave facies that have been mapped earlier by David Beeson as dilute currents decoupling from the more concentrated flows. So we can also take a look at where we think we're eroding in this area. And these models have the capacity to model things like bed shear stress at the base. So if we use shear stress as a proxy for the most likely place for erosion, then we can see this is consistent with what we're mapping. And so this is just an image where the red colors, the warmer colors, are the highest bed shear stress, up to 10 to the 4th kilopascal. And we see that shear stresses are predicted to be in the same area where we've expected to have our erosion. So this is consistent with our field evidence for picking up these lithics locally in this area. This is just a simple model of flow down a channel, showing that you can also map out shear stress. And you have a lot of shear stress at the head of the current and along the sides of the channel. This is just a slice through the simple channelized model, showing that also when you channelize a flow, you produce an enhanced density gradient. And so you see this is just particle volume fraction here. You have a higher particle volume fraction at the base, and you have a more dilute current above this. And I think this is consistent with this field evidence here, where you have, when you have these channels, you have an accumulation of dense lithics at the base and a very quick gradation up to the mass of Lapilli Tuff. So this, I think, is field evidence for this enhanced density gradient when you channelize a flow. These models also predict that when you channelize a flow, you increase the competence of the flow and it allows you to transport these particles further. So in this case, this channel was cut by a flow coming through, and as the flows continued, either from the next flow phase or sustained flow, you are being able to transport these larger lithics much further from source. So just to summarize, we have a lot of field evidence that the pyroclastic currents produced during the afternoon eruption were capable of eroding into the substrate, picking up large blocks and transporting them tens of meters downstream. And this gives us insight into the erosive capacity of the current. It also it seems that the increased bulk concentration at the base of the flow is promoting further erosion, both into debris avalanche hummocks as well as earlier pyroclastic flow deposits. We also see that this channelization or self-channelization is occurring independent of flow obstacles, and that this is having a significant effect on the overall flow dynamics, allowing flows to go further and carry their deposits or their larger lithics further from source. And so this is just one of the examples where we can use this field data and couple it with numerical models to understand something about the flow dynamics of pyroclastic currents. So, thank you.
Thank you very much, Brittany. Are there questions? Yes, please.
A lot of the lithic blocks in the debris avalanche deposits are highly fractured, and so my question is, did you see evidence of continued breakage of these clasts during transport by the PFs, or were they transported fairly intact?
Yeah, that's a good question. So I think it's kind of hard to say, really, because the debris avalanche deposits on the outside are very fractured. That's a good question. I think we're going to be doing some roundness studies as well, looking at in these lithic lenses and trying to constrain how much. I think you could probably do that by looking at the roundness of the accidentals, seeing if you have evidence for breakage. Because, for example, some of these are extremely hydrothermally altered, and you can see that they are just basically pulverized downstream. So you might see evidence of a higher proportion of these in the matrix, and that might tell you that you're disaggregating the blocks. But otherwise, it's probably.
Yeah, sometimes in the avalanche deposit itself, you get clusters of very angular clasts that relate to minimal transport, but breaking apart of some of these clasts.
And that's another way that we're able to distinguish these coming from the debris avalanche hummocks versus coming from source, because you would expect that these clasts would be more angular than the ones that have been transported from the volcano. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
All right, thank you. It's time to move on. Just to mention briefly that the second next talk is looking into the erosion of PECs as well, or again. But now, first of all, we have a talk by Shane Cronin, Lube, Sumarti, Sayudi, Subandrio, and Surono talking on transport and destruction dynamics of lethal pyroclastic density currents at Gunung Merapi on 26 October. La, 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 la. Thank you.
Thank you, Uli. Okay. So thank you. We're going back to Merapi. We heard a little bit about Merapi earlier in the day with Kimberly. And we're going to talk about some of the activity in 2010. And I guess the take-home message here is in the title, and I'm hoping to convince you of what I've said in the title through this next 15 minutes. If I can get this thing to move. Okay. Oh, we got the wrong keyboard. Okay. So our motivation for working in Merapi is more or less how can we understand some of the hazard aspects of these normally quite channelized flows. We're concentrating on block and ash flows, dense pyroclastic density currents that mostly sit down in the channel, and we're interested in the situations when they come out of channels where people don't tend to live and come out onto the flat areas where people tend to live and tend to have their farms. And so we've been trying to work on this process in a number of different volcanoes around the world, but this has been a really good location since about 2006 to study these processes. So Gert and I have spent a lot of time trying to understand some of the geometrical and physical constraints here. In the general sense, we have channel-confined facies, block and ash flow facies, these things which effectively belong to the channel facies and are dense flows that have spilled out from the side of the channel or in various other locations of constriction, and then these surge components. And this is a kind of nice, well-behaved, relatively small event, the one that occurred in 2006. And here we learnt, righto, we fill up the valley with the black fascies, the channel fill fascies. When we have larger flows, we can spill out at particular locations into the red fascies, and these can carry on trundling their way down valleys and become reconfined again. Effectively, portions of this dense PDC material that's been down the main channel that have spilled out. And we have the yellow zones, which are kind of our ash cloud surges associated. Now, the conditions under which these occur are when the channel capacity is at its minimum, but primarily they occur when you have a rapid change in channel capacity. So a sudden drop in channel capacity is where we get these flows primarily jumping out from the main channel, as we like to say. And also the other main indicator is where there's the increase in channel sinuosity. So that is very tight bends, and a series of tight bends tend to encourage the flows to spill out. In 2010, we had somewhat similar situation in the central part of the flow, so we had things trundling along the valley a rather long way and some spilling out to the sides. But the main difference in 2010 was that we had these very large areas affected by quite violent lower density pyroclastic surges. In fact, on this side, we're going to be concentrating because this is where the most violent flows tended to occur. Some major differences in volume between the two events, and this was one of the largest eruptions in recent history. A lot of people evacuated, but despite the evacuations, there were still a number of people killed. The little red dots on this map are locations where people are living, so houses and so on. So you can see people are living up quite high in this area. Kalliorang is an area of where mostly rich people have got holiday homes. A lot of people were killed, both due to the very long run out of the channel-confined flow, but also the very widespread and rather violent low-density flows. One of the questions from Kimberly's presentation was that was there associated flow ash fall and so on. In fact, there was ash fall throughout the entire eruption, and this is over downwind of the volcano of the dome, where primarily we have only ash fall, and there's ash falls associated with all phases of the eruption, and these very thin ash falls actually generated quite a lot of lahars after the first rains. In fact, more lahars were generated on this side of the volcano with very thin fall than there were generated in the main valley. A series of pyroclastic flows, I'm going to concentrate on the 5th and the 26th, and these were the ones that are associated with the most violent surges. Just a quick look at the geometric budget. Okay, just concentrating on the 5th of November here, we have a much larger volume than we had in 2006. But the interesting thing is when we start looking at the distribution of that volume of material. 2006, the bulk of it's contained within the channel. Here we've got 72% contained within the channel, but only 8% of the area affected by this event is the channel-confined facies. In fact, the bulk of the area affected by the event was affected by only 5% of the volume of this 5th of November flow and surge combo. We plot these things up on some standard sort of energy dispersion mobility type plots. These are the 2006 major flows in red. The 26th flow is in blue, and the fifth one is in green. And it's clear they don't really belong in this plot. And this is combining all the products together. So if we just recalculate this and say, okay, here's our channel and over spill part. So if you like the rather more sedate flow that trundles down the valley, that's sitting here where it belongs and amongst the typical other block and ash flows that we've seen from Merapi, Montserrat, and a few other places. And then we have these surge components, which are sitting out here, rather more mobile than anything else in this particular plot. And in fact, once we start looking at these in relation to blast, evidence in the literature, these are the St. Helens, Bismiami things. They're much larger volume, much larger dispersion. Here's one from Sufria Hills. So these are quite energetic events, blast-like energy. If we start looking closer at the flow, this is Gunung Kendil, and I'm going to keep talking about Gunung Kendil. This is the dotted line marks the edge of a large cliff. Channel facies in blue, and these lines are indicating trees falling down, and the red zones are zones of damage, which I'll get into a bit later. So we've got a flow that's come down here, and we've got quite a lot of direction, quite a lot of lateral spread of flow here. Down the main valley, where the red spot is, typical block and ash flow, typical dense flow sequence, and most of the major events are represented here, and some rather larger ones on the 1st and the 3rd of November. There's nothing too surprising in that lot. The surprising thing here is, in the summit of the volcano is up here, about where the 26 is, our flows descend this slope, they impact against Gunung Kendil, they carry on trundling down the Skendol Valley, but clearly a large portion of the flow is spilling out here, following the red arrow, across this very, very high, steep ridge. Notice these trees are all sitting here quite happily. That's the direct line to the summit. So these flows didn't come down this way. They came out this way. Turning around and looking downflow now, and this is looking towards. So we're standing at the red spot, and we're looking towards Kaliurang. Kaliurang is just behind this ridge line here, and we've got massive stripping of vegetation along in the direction of Kaliurang. They surmounted steep ridges. It's very steep terrain here. Typical deposition patterns for relatively low density flows. So we're getting deposition primarily in the lee sides of obstacles. Trees are getting knocked down across the valley. And we've got very superficial charring. We haven't got very thick deposits, so we're not getting very, very good charcoal preserved. Mostly pretty thin deposits. And we are jumping across this very steep terrain. So we're not going down the valleys, we're coming across the terrain in the first instance. And as we get further across from ridge to ridge, the deposits thin. As we get further out, we get a few more ash falls, but we've still got some surges. We're getting slightly less damage. And as we get right out to the lateral margins, we're getting only the 5th of November surge. We've lost the early 26th surge, and we've lost most of the ash falls just because of the main dispersal direction of that ash. Going down the main central part of the surge, flow coming from left to right in this top picture and right to left in the bottom picture, just to confuse you. Just stripping away houses and trees in this area, about 5 kilometres from the volcano, we get some nice bed forms. A lot of the nice dune structures seem to be related to the topography. We've seen some quite nice dune sets, which are pretty spectacular in places. We get a bit further away, the lateral walls are remaining. The walls that are protected by steps in the landscape are remaining, but there's still quite a lot of major destruction. We get further away, the deposits get thinner. We retain our houses, we damage them, we pepper them with impact marks, but these things were still pretty hot. We still char grasses and we still generate little degassing pipes. This is a... We were struggling for some words here to define zones of equal damage intensity, and so Gert came up with the idea that we'd call these things isokoppos. We're not married to this term, so if anybody knows of another one, please let us know of a better way of describing these things. But this is a map, effectively, of impact. We've got one for both vegetation and one for infrastructure. We'll go through the vegetation one. So the red zone here in A, primarily just opposite this impact zone against Kandil, is where all the soil is actually stripped off completely and the trees are removed, which has, by the way, given us a rather nice tephra sequence, which we've sampled 340 prehistoric Merapi tephras through here. So that'll be next year. Further down, you can see these zones, and they're crossing the topography. And they're crossing the topography, and eventually they're starting to drape down into the topography. So soil intact, trees stripped off through to various extremes, and at the end we've just got the leaves stripped off. So the mechanism of the surge generation, well, some of the evidence we're seeing is that we've got this cross-valley flow, we've got this very steep margin in the Gendol Valley. It's not coming down the hill, it's coming out of the Gendol Valley aside. If we look on top of Gunung Kendil, the impact zone, so flows coming from here down to here, we've got an unusual sequence of falls which are quite out of context with the rest of the deposit, so quite localised falls in this region right on top of the Gunung Kendil. So it appears that this has blocked the main drainage of flows. Interestingly, this valley was very, very deep and forested. Since 2006, has filled up with block and ash flow deposits and rockfall deposits. So this Gunung Kendil has come into play. We've had these dense flows come down here, hit this. Perhaps there's been some secondary fragmentation. We're not quite sure exactly what the mechanism is here, but there's definitely been fragmentation of some respect. Perhaps a column here constructed, but definitely we're getting flow out of the valley, directed straight across the area towards Kalyurung, and we had a directed, extremely energetic surge with rather blast-like dynamics. Thanks.
Thank you, Shane. There's time for questions.
I just have a quick question. So in those distal, how distal were those areas where you were impacting the houses, but they were intact? How much further did the surges go? Past that?
Impacting the houses, but they're still intact.
Yeah, here, right, the pitted. So my question is related to this. So how can you constrain the flow thickness at this location using the pitted poles? And have you thought about using that to get impact velocities of the particles at the location?
Yes, we've been trying to collect as much information about the height as possible. And in some cases it's difficult because a lot of the highest elements are the trees, and off the weakest part of the tree is obviously where the branches really start out. And if you've got tall, skinny trees branching out, then you'll break them at that point. So we're struggling with a range of different evidence at the moment to try and work out that height of flow. But yes, we're trying to do that. And in terms of distance, this is 8 kilometres from the source along that main central part. But that distance is very dependent on where you are in relation to the centre of that surge.
Why is there so much accretionary lapilli in that deposit?
The accretionary lapilli is not necessarily in the surge deposits, but there's a lot of co-surge fall that's containing accretionary lapilli. Very, very humid area, a lot of rain.
So is it just the environment, not any other water source, the vegetation, or, I mean, what do you think the water source is, I guess?
It was, the weather wasn't all that good in the first parts of the eruption, so I think the primary water source is atmospheric water.
Thanks.
Clouds.
I have one quick question. You mentioned that the dune bed forms are related to morphology. Can you quickly comment on whether they are rather on the heights or on the lows?
Okay. So the morphology in this area is quite interesting. It's a terraced area, so people are flattening out areas to farm and put their houses on it. So each time you drop down a terrace, drop down a nice little hydraulic jump, you get these beautiful bed forms immediately thereafter.
Okay, thanks, Shane. I'm going to move to the next talk that is given by Duye, Cooper's, Rasmussen, Merrison, and Dingwell, and the title is Erosive Events in Diluted Pyroclastic Density Currents.
So, ladies and gentlemen, today I'm going to talk about erosion in dilute PDCs and wind tunnel experiments we've done with colleagues in Aarhus University. So, what I call a dilute pyroclastic density current in my title is any kind of pyroclastic density current which produces cross stratification. This implies attraction flow boundary at the interface with the bed, as shown in this sketch from Brainy and Kochler. Attractional flow boundary is produced by a flow with a low particle concentration, shown by the dotted line, and consequent lateral velocities represented by the full line. So there are two reasons for the study. The first is that we observe typical and characteristic stratification patterns in PDC deposits that are absent in the record of other sedimentary environments. So one question is whether vesiculated and angular volcanic particles behave differently from rounded sand. The second idea is that from an erosion plane in a cross-stratified deposit, we can access the nature of the particles that were eroded from the remaining part in blue here. And we can experimentally measure the minimum shearing necessary for such erosion to occur, giving an estimate of the minimum wind speed that acted during the flow that produced this erosion. So, just a few words about particle transport. Particles in suspension are fully supported in the gas phase, and they don't interact with the bed. Saltation consists of alternate jump and landing of the particles, and surface creep are the particles that always stay on the ground. So, that's just... Can you click? So that's just a quick movie of saltating particles. So, not the jump with different lengths and height, and if you're lucky, you can see some landing particles that are ejecting other ones. Particles are pumice between 0.5 and 1 millimeter diameter. The video is 1/10 of speed and was recorded in our wind tunnel. So note that saltation is the first transport process to begin when you increase the wind speed, and thus it represents the onset of saltations. So that's why we did wind tunnel experiments and tried to characterize the saltation threshold for volcanic particles. Our device is 6 meters long. There is a motor at the exit of the tunnel that sucks the air from the entrance that that is blowing through the section. Inside the wind tunnel, we put roughness blocks at the inlet to guarantee an initial turbulence. This is followed by 4 meters of what we call a roughness carpet that consists of grains of the studied samples glued on the bed. And it permits to rapidly adjust the turbulent equilibrium for each investigated sample. The test section is 1 meter long and consists of a 2 centimeter thick layer of loose particles to be eroded. So for each experiment, we progressively increase the wind speed until a small but continuous number of particles left the surface. this observation was done visually and taken as the saltation threshold. So we then measure the wind speed with a pitot tube 5 meters downstream the entrance and over the quiescent surface of the deposit. So we have used two types of particles, pumices and scoriaceous material, both coming from Larzace quarries. They're wet sieved in 1 feet intervals between 125 microns and 4 millimeters for the scoria and up to 16 millimeters for the pumices. I want to insist on the fact that we look at boundary processes only. We don't make any modeling, and thus we don't try any scaling. There's no PDC conditions, such as temperature, particle concentration, and the flows are steady. We only study volcanic particles, not a flow. Our experiments are made in a turbulent flow boundary, that is, with turbulent eddies produced at the interface with the bed. So that's why it was important to put the roughness carpet on the upwind side of our setup. Such eddies dramatically increase the energy transfers from the flow to the bed and the wind velocity, which is well documented from many studies, is a logarithmic function of the height above the bed as seen in the graph and the equation for the velocity below. But when it comes to compare different wind profiles, it's more practical to go to a semi-log scale since it permits to directly access the variables in the equation, as you can see here. So for the following, all my wind profiles will be in semi-log scales. There are only two parameters in the equation of the wind speed. The first is this Z0, and it's called the surface roughness. It quantifies how rough is the bed, the texture. Graphically, it's the height at which the velocity virtually decreases to zero. It is largely accepted and empirically documented that the surface roughness equals the particle diameter divided by 30 for rounded particles. Also, note that the surface roughness is a function of the bed texture and of the particles, not of the winds. The second parameter in the wind speed equation is this U star, which is called the shear velocity. It has the dimension of a velocity, but it represents the shear stress. Graphically, it's the slope of the logarithmic wind profile. It is also a record of how efficient the turbulent energy transfer is, and thus the level of turbulence. And actually, the shear velocity is much more practical to use than the wind speed, which depends on height. So now I'll show you my results. These are the wind profiles at the threshold for saltation for the scoria samples. The colors refer to the grain size, and you can see that we have typical logarithmic turbulent profiles. We have a good reproducibility for the grain size that have been repeated. The fines are easier to erode than the cores, which means that we don't change the physics and dominant forces acting for the whole range of grain sizes. Finally, just to give an idea, the wind speed at 10 cm 8 range between 5 and 18 meters per second. So now, those are the results for the pumice samples. Here again, the colors refer to the grain size. We have logarithmic wind profiles. The fines, yep, we have a good reproducibility, and the fines are easier to erode than the cores. However, for all the profiles between 125 microns and 1 millimeter, all these profiles are more or less similar. And so we think that there might be a laminar sublayer acting in the vicinity of the bed during our experiments here. The velocities are ranging between 3 and 8 meters per second for the same grain sizes as the scoria samples. And for eroding 8 to 16 millimeter samples, we needed a velocity of 16 meters per second. So now let's have a look at the surface roughness. This is a plot of the measured surface roughness as a function of the grain size of the samples for each experiment. The white lines represent the grain size intervals. And our results agree with the empirical relation between grain size and roughness for rounded particles. However, We still observe a deviation with surface roughness smaller than expected for the finds, which again can be the effect of a laminar sublayer close to the bed. For the coarse fraction, the roughness is a bit higher than expected, and this possibly means that the shape of the particles begins to affect the bed texture and roughness. The deviations are, however, rather small and typical of this kind of experiments. So this graph is not a wind profile. For each of my experiments, I plot the shear velocity to initiate saltation, so the slope of the of a wind profile here, as a function of the grain size. And the scoria results are in red, the pumice in blue, and in green are results from Iversen for different types of densities and rounded particles. You see that pumices are easier to erode than scoria, since for a given grain size, you need a lower shear velocity to initiate saltation. Also, for low friction speeds, or where Iversen has data, our results collapse on the standard curves of similar densities, here at 2.5 for the scoria and at about 1 for the pumices. So density and grain size seems to be the main parameters for the erosion threshold, also for volcanic ash. Now, finally, I'll talk about the effect of slope, since we can vary the inclination of our wind tunnel. In this graph are the wind profiles for saltation threshold for a single sample, but for different bed slopes. And since we use the same particles for all the experiments, the surface roughness doesn't change. But you see that one needs to increase the shear velocity to initiate saltation when the wind blows more uphill. So now this graph plots the threshold shear velocity versus the slope angle, and the threshold, the shear velocity are normalized to the zero slope threshold. You can see that for all samples, one need a higher shearing to initiate saltation when the wind is blowing upslope. And this is expectable, since if you look at the forces acting on the particle, that is the weight, drag, and lift forces, the weight will be facilitating erosion when blowing downslope, whereas it acts against the drag in the upslope slating. So this is really interesting because it can partly explain the widespread occurrence of upstream migrating bedforms in PDC deposits, since erosion and re-entrainment is easier to reach on the downslope lee side than on the stow side. So, in summary, we've seen that the surface roughness is dependent on the grain size mainly, and in the same way as rounded particles. The threshold shear velocity for saltation is dependent on the density and grain size, and also in the same way as rounded particle. So that is, density and grain size are the main parameters for the saltation threshold, which means that in my experiments, volcanic particles just behave like beads. And it seems that the shape of volcanic particles has little or no influence on the boundary layer. We have also seen that saltation begins at higher shear velocities when we are blowing upslope, and this could explain the formation of upstream migrating bed forms. And finally, we've defined the lower limit for the occurrence of erosive events in dilute PDCs, and this could permit a quantification of field observations and maybe serve as an input for numerical models. So thank you for your attention.
So, there is any question for Guilhem? Apparently not. Okay, so let's move on. Thank you, Guilhem. Let's go on to the next presentation. So, next presentation is bedform reconstruction using terrestrial laser scanner scanning at Hunts Hole, New Mexico, implication for sediment transport in pyroclastic surge deposit and criteria for their identification on Mars is given by Edgar Grotzinger, Ewing Southard, and Lamb.
All right, thank you. Well, Today I'm going to talk about what we can learn from pyroclasts that are preserved in bed forms in pyroclastic surge deposits. This is work that I've done at Hunts Hole, New Mexico, with the other co-authors listed here. In this talk, I'll give a brief background and my motivation for the project coming from the Mars community. I'll briefly discuss the geologic setting and the methods that we used, and then spend the majority of the talk talking about the observations and interpretations, and conclude with a summary and some future work. So first I want to start with the terminology, since there's a lot of different terms floating around out there. So when I say pyroclastic surge, I mean one that's produced in a dilute pyroclastic density current. These are dilute flows of gas and rock fragments where the clasts are supported by the turbulence of the fluid rather than collisional momentum transfer. I should also point out that everything I'm discussing here is from a cold surge generated by a phreatomagmatic eruption. So bed forms in phreatomagmatic surges were first described in detail back in the 70s. So we see two images here, one from Schwinke et al. In 1973, looking at the Locker Sea area, which we just saw in the previous talk. And they describe what they think are chute and pool structures, indicating sediment transport from left to right, representing a hydraulic jump. Other authors, like Crow and Fisher, have described anti-dunes at Ubihibi Crater, suggesting that perhaps these crest lines are migrating upstream. And we've seen today and other work where people have described these bed forms more quantitatively, looking at angles of Stoss and Lee slopes, angles of climb, some grain size. But there's still a lot that we don't know about the bed form kinematics. This next slide I wanted to use as a cautionary note for making interpretations about the flow based on bed form geometries. So the lower two images are images that I took at Hunts Hole, New Mexico, that perhaps look a little bit similar to chute and pool structures or anti-dunes that were proposed in other locations. But the cautionary note is that in this bottom example, we're actually looking at, rather than a chute and pool structure, the flow is into the bore, and we're looking at part of a large trough that's scoured into some planar beds. In the other example, you can think of this as possibly anti-dunes, where the crest line might appear to be migrating upstream. But actually, if you look around this outcrop in three dimensions, you can see that this is actually an oblique cut, and what we're just seeing is shifting crest lines. So the take-home message is that cross-stratified deposits provide an important record of flow conditions if properly interpreted. So it's really useful if you have outcrops where you can get the full perspective by walking around the entire outcrop. So my motivation for the project comes from the debate about identifying pyroclastic surges on Mars. So the images here come from the two rover landing sites. This is Spirit site in Gusev Crater, the Opportunity landing site at, and this is Endurance Crater here. And in one case, we think that we have strong evidence for pyroclastic surges. There's even a possible bomb sag shown here. But in the other site, what's actually Aeolian deposits was initially proposed to be impact or volcanic-based surge deposits. So what this suggests is that we have a need to establish better criteria for recognizing these deposits in remote sensing applications in the absence of volcanic indicators such as bombs or lapilli. And also, we have a limited understanding of bedform kinematics in these surges on Earth. So to try and address these questions, I went to Hunts Hole and Kilburn Hole, located in southern New Mexico, about 30 miles southwest of Las Cruces. These are two Pleistocene volcanic craters that were produced during steam explosions when magma came in contact with groundwater. And I'm going to focus mostly on Hunts Hole, which is back here, because the geomorphic pattern around the rim of the crater provides exposures where you can actually walk around full three sides of an outcrop, and these exposures are at the scale of the bed forms. So here we see we get about 2 to 13 meters of stratigraphy that are exposed, and the clasts are sourced from the underlying Camp Rice formation, which is actually Rio Grande rift fill, so it consists of fluvial and in some places lacustrine deposits and some gravel. So the methods that I used included field observations, so initially mapping flow directions, measuring stratigraphic sections, but then we used some new technology, including terrestrial laser scanning, which is based on light detection and ranging, or LIDAR. So these LIDAR scans actually allow us to produce millimeter to centimeter scale resolution digital elevation models, which are very helpful for making precise measurements of bed forms. All the data was processed using Quick Terrain Modeler and a new program, LIDAR Viewer, which was developed by the Keck Caves group up at UC Davis. I also compared this technique to some 3D modeling using digital photographs that was produced by Autodesk Labs. So moving on to the field observations, the first thing that strikes you is that the outcrop is dominated by these decimeter to meter scale climbing dunes. And we see actually very high angles of climb, in some places approaching 30 to 50 degrees, which is very rare. You almost never see this in dunes on Earth. You might see the angles of climb approaching that in ripples, but never of bed forms of this scale. We also see extreme grain size variations over just kind of centimeter scale. The bottom example here, you go from coarse to fine to coarse material over just a few four sets of this dune. We also note that truncated sets pass upward into draping and planar bedding, so you actually get full bed forms preserved here. This is another example of truncated sets that actually get draped and move into planar bedding towards the top of the deposit. And also near the top of the deposit, you see small sets of ripple-like bed forms. But note that this is happening in grain sizes of very coarse sand versus fine sand, which you would find in subaqueous ripples like this. So now I'd like to show some of the results using these LiDAR scans. So the first thing to point out, this is a LiDAR scan on the top compared to a photograph. The LiDAR was shot from a slightly further away location, so there's a bush that comes up in this image that you don't see in the bottom. But with that exception, this is actually a very good match. And you can see that we can easily detect cross-bedding in LiDAR scans. And so we think that the intensity of the return is probably a function of grain size, packing, and changes in composition. So we can use these LiDAR scans to then make bed form measurements. For example, measuring angles of lee side, staw side laminae. In some locations, you can select points, fit a plane to it, extract a strike and dip. This was actually used to show that bed forms transition from 3D bed forms, which are poorly fit by a plane, up into 2D and planar laminae near the top, which are well fit by a plane. And I also wanted to compare the LiDAR intensity to grain size. So here I've selected points from what appears to be a very dark area, a medium-toned area, and a very light deposit. And what we see is that the dark, lower intensity return from LiDAR corresponds to very coarse-grained material. Bottom here, I've just plotted the intensity distribution, where 0 represents black, 255 is white. And if we move on, you can see that the medium-toned material corresponds to medium and fine-grained sand, and the light material corresponds to the very fine ash deposit that's draping this at the top. So it appears that the LiDAR intensity values are well correlated with grain size based on the images. And what I'm working on now is to see if we can use these intensity distributions as a proxy for grain size. So I still need to calibrate these with grain size analysis, but you can see the intensity distributions for the dark, medium, and light tone areas and the cumulative frequency curves here. So we think that it's a pretty good fit, and this is something I'm working on now to calibrate. So now I'd like to compare the LiDAR data to the 3D models that we've produced using photogrammetry. So this is using a program by Autodesk Labs known as 123D Catch, or previously known as Project PhotoFly. So this combines data from a series of images that are taken about every 5 or 10 degrees as you move around the outcrop, covering all angles if possible. And it uses photogrammetry and cloud computing to produce 3D models from digital photographs. You can see in some places we have wooden blocks of known dimensions and spacing that we use to try and calibrate and compare this model to the LiDAR. We see in most cases actually that even though it's not quite as precise as LiDAR, we do get within 1 to 2 centimeters of the expected values. So it's a pretty good match. And what's very convenient is that you can better visualize these surfaces in 3D. So the video here is just showing you one of these 3D models. And what we try and do is use this in combination with LiDAR because you can better visualize the surfaces in visible imagery and then make the measurements using LiDAR. So we'll just play that one more time so you can get a sense of the 3D nature here. All right. So the next few slides go over some of these observations and measurements that I've made on bed forms, such as wavelength and wave height. And here I've compared the data at Hunt's Hole to data from Crow and Fisher at Ubi-Hebe Crater. And what we see is that wave height increases with wavelength, and that these measurements were actually made about the same distance from the vent. So what this suggests is that we're seeing greater wavelengths and amplitudes at Hunt's Hole, So perhaps this was formed in a more powerful flow at Hunt's Hole compared to another surge at Ubihibi Crater. I also looked at angles of Stoss and Lee side, again compared to that at Ubihibi Crater. For the most part, we're seeing angles of Lee sides that are steeper than those of Stoss sides, so it's kind of interesting following the talk previous to this. But there are a few exceptions, which we think are due to local variations in topography. And then the last observation we made was looking at how the angle of climb varied through the evolution of these bed forms. So this is an example of a climbing bed form here. And what I've plotted is angle of climb versus position along the dune. So here are just a few examples, but what we initially see is a sharp increase in the angle of climb, then it drops off, and then it rises rapidly. So what this suggests is that the rate of accumulation is initially very high, then the bed form gets washed downstream, and then you rapidly accumulate again. So there's this balance between the rate of accumulation and the rate of migration, and generally we're seeing very high rates of accumulation. So in vertical succession, we see bed forms pass upwards from truncation to draping. We have the angle of climb increasing, the bulk grain size tends to decrease. The pili become more abundant, and we get these small ripple-like bed forms that appear near the top of the deposit. So this is all consistent with a flow that's decelerating in time, as expected. And so what we think is that the deposit represents one event, and it probably the density of the fluid is somewhere in between that of water and air, so we're dealing with some sort of intermediate, very dusty, dense gas. The majority of the deposit also suggests that we're only looking at low flow regime conditions. We're not seeing any upper plane bed or anti-dunes as described in other locations. We also propose that there's a distinctive style of stratification on the basis of grain size and angle of climb. And again, the rate of accumulation is much greater than the rate of migration, so we're preserving large fractions of these set thicknesses and in some places preserving entire bed forms. So then I tried to estimate the flow depth, and we have two end members, either subaqueous dunes, where I'm following Allen 1968. Given the wavelengths that we measured, you might expect the flow depth to be about 1 or 2 meters. But obviously the other endpoint would be subaerial dunes, which have very large flow depths. So we're probably, and based on the thickness of the deposit, probably looking at a surge thickness that's probably on the order of tens of meters. But we suggest that perhaps this value that we've measured might represent the thickness of the frictional boundary layer that the dunes are actually feeling. So I'll end with how we might be able to identify these deposits on Mars. They're easily distinguished from Aeolian deposits based on extreme grain size variations. We can distinguish them from fluvial deposits based on the presence of fines, which would be washed out in a fluvial deposit that could be transporting gravel, and very high rates of climb. So with that, I will take any questions.
Thank you very much. There is any question? There's one question from Uli.
Yes, my question is, do your 3D reconstructions allow to say whether the truncation planes are flat or like curved bend something?
Yeah, so it looks like most of the truncation surfaces that we are seeing are actually poorly fit by a plane. So we do think that they are curvoplanar surfaces. But that, again, ties back to the fact that these are 3D bed forms that are being truncated. The truncations up near the top of the deposit would be planar.
Any more questions? Not a lot of chances left this year. Okay, so we continue the next talk. Is insights into eruption dynamics at Stromboli volcano from real-time collection of ash and lapilli samples. And the authors are Lautze, Tadeucci, Houghton, Andronico, and Scarlato, and the talk is given by Nicole.
And I guess this talk is going to be a little bit different because it's going to talk about what we learn from pyroclasts if you collect them as they're falling from the sky. Okay, let me get situated here. Okay, and so when I wrote this title, I thought that I was a bit ambitious and I thought I was going to have time to speak about both my past work on the pili at Stromboli and my more recent work on ash at Stromboli. In the interest of time, I'm just going to talk about my more recent work on ash. So what are the motivations to study ash? Well, really there's relatively few modern studies of volcanic ash, And although it's relatively safe and easy to collect, it's inherently more difficult to analyze due to its small size. So we wanted to address general questions such as, can we infer magmatic processes from ash samples? And then I was interested in looking into why or how low-intensity basaltic explosions emit ash. So we have fairly fluid magma with basalt, and generally we think that there's an increase in fragmentation with explosivity. So it's not surprising to get ash from a more explosive, for instance, Plinian eruption. But why would we see particularly fluidal ash from a basaltic explosion? And then we wanted to address questions more specific to Stromboli, such as, can we correlate the abundance of juvenile ash with explosion intensity? And then does ash from neighboring craters look similar? And does paroxysmal ash look different? So I'm going to present data on ash samples from two time periods. One is a crisis that occurred at Stromboli between February and May of 2007. And second, during ash samples collected during a three-day field campaign in 2009. And I'll present data collected using a binocular microscope and using a field emission scanning electron microscope that's located at the INGV in Rome. And the SEM at the INGV in Rome is exciting because it is linked to some particle analysis software, which is relatively new. And using the software, we can obtain morphology and surface chemistry data relatively rapidly in a semi-automatic fashion. First, a little bit of background. What's a Strombolian eruption? So this is a video, thanks to Matt Patrick, of a single Strombolian explosion. So the eruptions occur as a sequence of explosions like this over time. They're considered to be relatively mild, and usually the ejecta fall quite close to the vent. The model for how this occurs is that there's a slug of relatively large gas bubbles that ascend through stationary magma, burst at the free surface, and eject a shower of fragments. When I started work on Stromboli, we wanted to look at the properties of the shallow magma and did so by collecting pyroclasts. Most people probably know about Stromboli. It's located in the Aeolian Islands. It's an active volcano and has been active since ancient Greek and Roman times. One main conduit feeds three craters, the northeast, central, and southwest. Ejecta fallout is usually restricted to an area within this hatched line, which is a higher and older crater rim, and often rolls down the Chata del Fuoco. There's a range of explosion styles considered typical at Stromboli. Matt Patrick classified these as type 1, which are Lapillian bomb rich, type 2A, which are ash rich and contain Lapillian bombs as well, and then ash explosions that lack the larger particles. Atypically, Stromboli also has phases of lava fusion and much more intense explosions. Both of these occurred in 2003 and 2007, and so currently the frequency is being reassessed. We used to say once a decade and once a century, but it seems like they might occur more frequently. So now going into my analysis of 2007 crisis samples, first a little bit about the crisis. There was a phase of lava fusion that happened between late February and early April. A paroxysm occurred about midway through this on 15th of March, and there was also sporadic summit crater activity. Seven ash samples were collected and analyzed on these dates, and so I just want to point out that one sample is from the paroxysm on March, and that two samples were collected after the phase of lava fusion, so it must be from summit crater activity. The map on the left here shows the location of sample collection, and then on the right I show three SEM images from each sample. So I'll just draw your attention to the ash from the paroxysm. So notice that the first two shown are fairly glassy, have nice angular edges, and the last is fairly highly altered. And then those collected after the lava fusion show kind of abundant aggregate material and a large degree of alteration. So here I show the morphology data, so parameters of class diameter, compactness, and elongation. The diameter data can be considered a proxy for a grain size distribution. It's relatively easy to obtain using the software. So I'm just going to point out that the sample from the paroxysm has the smallest median diameter and is the best sorted. We see a range of grain size distributions. the parameters of compactness and elongation tend to show all samples are generally uniform in shape, which might be a limitation of the method. Perhaps is due to similar fragmentation process, or fragmentation process is too similar to differentiate using this technique. Moving on to the surface chemistry, this image is meant to show how the data is obtained. So the data would essentially be the bulk surface chemistry of everything within this rectangle here. And a rectangle is drawn on each ash particle, so we get a distribution of surface chemistry data. This can be considered a proxy for componentry because it can highlight alteration phases in crystals. So in the top plot here, we have major elements, and note that all the samples plot within the approximate vicinity of Stromboli melt. So this M here is the bulk chemistry of Stromboli's melt, or glass chemistry, actually. And on the bottom, we plot alteration phases of sodium and chlorine, and this serves to distinguish between samples quite well. So these samples have a strong tendency towards the sulfur or gypsum alteration, and these two have a trend towards a halite alteration down here. Putting all of this together in a summary slide, kind of make three points. It was the abundance of halite in two of the samples that led us to conclude a probable origin at the ocean entry, the chlorine and the halite coming from the seawater. Interesting about the pyroxysm, less interesting is that there's vitreous class, because that's what we would expect, but we noticed that some of the vitreous class had the gypsum alteration, and in fact some of the vitreous class with the chemical composition of Stromboli's golden pumice, which only occurs during pyroxysms and otherwise major explosions, had the gypsum alteration, which might indicate that that can occur very quickly, alteration between fragmentation and deposition. And finally, the fact that the last two samples collected had large amount of aggregate material, microcrystalline class, and some alteration of gypsum might suggest that there was a lack of fresh magma in the system or a plugged vent system at the end of the crisis. So ultimately, we concluded that the distinctive textures and alteration signals aided us in identifying the different sources of ash during the 2007 crisis. I'll move on to the three-day sampling campaign in 2009. I was fortunate to be included with the INGV scientists in this. Notice that there's a lack of visibility at the summit. This shows how we collected the ash samples. So we could actually see the explosions only on the 27th, though even on the 28th, I was excited about what was falling out of the sky. If you can see here, there's nice fluidal Pele's hair looking material. Here's some pictures, binocular microscope images of the ash. So on the 27th, we have some nice fluidal material along with some pink lithics. On the 28th, we see Pele's hair, lack of lithics, and very fluidal material. So these two are from the 28th. And on the 29th, we see more ragged gray material. Fortunately, INGV has two monitoring video cameras up. And so using these videos, these both show that this explosion. We were able to distinguish which crater each sample came from and get an estimate of the jet height and jet duration. So we noticed that all samples on the 27th and 28th came from the southwest crater, and all on the 29th came from the northeast crater. So this shows binocular microscope images from each sample. Again, you see an increase in fluidity from the 27th to the 28th, and then less exciting material maybe on the 29th. So I divided each sample into four components: sideromelane, which is glassy and fluidal or highly vesicular, tachylite, which is microcrystalline, blocky, and less vesicular. So we saw an increase in the sideromelane content from the 27th to the 28th, and on the 29th, relatively equal proportions of the sideromelane, tachylite, and lithics. Here are some, I think, impressive SEM images from the samples. So again, from the 27th to the 28th, we see increasing particle fluidity with time. And on the 28th, there's less fluidal, more altered material, although there's still some nice sharp edges and vesicles. And two of my favorites here are this sample that has a nice elongated vesicle, and this one here looks like a jellyfish where there's fluidal magma wrapped around a crystal. Okay, getting into the data, again, the diameter data give us a nice range of class size distributions. Most of the larger samples are from the 27th and 28th, with the exception of one sample from the 29th, which is larger. And then down here, again, we see a relatively similar distribution of all samples, although I'll point out that the sample that stands out in black is this sample here, which is arguably the most fluidal and might lend some credence to the method. Again, all samples plot around Stromboli's melt, and we see a difference when we plot the alteration phases. We see less altered material on the 27th and 28th, which again was associated with higher jets, so we might be able to make a correlation there. And on the 29th, we see more altered material erupted. So bottom line for the 2009 stories is that I think the story makes sense. Still a work in progress, but I like what we're seeing. So we've documented that the very fluidal ash can be emitted at Stromboli. Also that texturally different material can be erupted from the two craters nearly simultaneously, which might be due to the relative openness of the vent system. And that fragmentation of fluidal ash size particles can occur, although I'm starting to question whether it might occur through stretching and breaking of larger particles rather than be a primary fragmentation process. And that's in part due to the final point I'm going to make, or thanks to some nice video we have. So remember, on the 27th, we had visibility. We collected two samples. We saw increasing sideromaline content from the 1203 explosion to the 2 o'clock explosion. And we have this really nice high speed video, which I'm just going to play and let play. And in this, I would just point out there's a lot more haze than in this one. This one is a lot cleaner explosion, which might make sense considering the different sideromaline content. Thanks.
Thank you, Nicole, for showing me in a ridiculous situation in the field and for trying to kill me with the laser pointer. There's any question about this presentation? Well, I have one. When you talk about the alteration in gypsum, what do you mean? I mean, it's something that is covering the glass, or is the glass that is altered? What do you mean?
It's a surface alteration, yeah, of the glass, which seems as though it can appear rapidly or slowly, because we found that the class that has the golden pumice texture, which must, or we would think, was fragmented in the paroxysm, the interior of the class had the golden pumice composition and the exterior had the gypsum alteration. So that's evidence that it occurred quickly, but we also see the gypsum alteration in particles that seem to be recycled and older.
So the next talk and last talk of this exciting session will be vesicle texture analysis of juvenile pyroclastics from the Pleistocene Lake Burrumbete Mar, new volcanic province in southern Australia, as given by Jordan and Cass.
Can't see your word, yeah. Thanks for staying so long and listening to the very last talk of this whole conference, I guess. Thank you. I'm talking about my work on Lake Parambit. It's a mar volcano in Western Victoria in South Australia. Lake Parambit is located, maybe I should use that one. Is located here in the New Volcanics province, which is to the west of Melbourne. Melbourne is located here. I give you a short overview of the geological background. The New Volcanics province is an intraplate monogenetic basaltic volcanic field. Volcanism started 4.5 million years ago, and went on until, to recent times. The last eruption is 4,500 years ago. Its size is 15,000 square kilometers, and it contains more than 400 eruption points. And these volcanoes have a whole variety, from small shield volcanoes over tuff rings and to mar volcanoes. Lake Pyramid itself is like 50,000, around 50,000 years old. It is an unusual large mare volcano. I think it's one of the largest in the world. It's 3 kilometers in diameter. It's ejected material containing lithics and juvenile clasts around 0.25 cubic kilometers. And the eruption style is made mainly phreatomagmatic. But we find several interbedded, very small, more magmatic layers in it. And this is where I concentrate my research on. I want to know what causes these changes in the eruption style. And we find these layers of more magmatics to the east, which is also the part or the facies type, which is way thicker. It's 40 meters thick, the whole succession in the east. And contains a whole variety of deposits. So my main deposits are more magmatic ones. Here, this one. And then I have dry phreatomagmatic, which are more ash-rich, and wet phreatomagmatic, fine ash, which is contains very abundant on accretionary lapilli. So if you look into the thin sections of these clasts, you see that they have different vesicularities and different vesical shapes. So I wanted to know if the vesicles are a factor influencing the changes in the eruption style. So I looked into thin sections of these different clasts. And what I wanted to know also is if I use clasts, which clasts size should I work on? So I used clasts from different class sizes. I chose 2 millimeters. So coarse ash and 0.5 millimeters. For the fine ash, we could only use a bulk sample because it's consolidated fine ash, so I had to work with this. I used a normal light microscope for the larger grain size and an electron microscope for the smaller ones in the fine ash. So then I converted my images into binary images, and then I used the image analysis program ImageJ to calculate the vesical area and shape parameters. From these results, I tried to calculate the bubble number densities, and here you can see the more magmatic ones where I have different grain sizes, dry phreatomagmatic and the wet phreatomagmatic. And what is very obvious, interesting, is that the smaller class size show actually bubble number densities which are two times to the power like larger than the larger grain sizes. And I thought this is surprising. You would think that larger grains have maybe like more bubbles in it and then you see also that the wet phreatomagmatic ones have a larger bubble number density as well. So if you put them in order, you have the largest bubble number densities in the wet phreatomagmatic ones and the smallest bubble number density in the dry phreatomagmatic ones. So then I looked into the bubble size distribution because I wanted to know if I missed any bubbles due to different using different microscopes. And if you look into it, it's a little bit small, but this is to 20 times 10 to the power of 6, and this is down here. So if you look at both graphs, this should be way higher if I missed something, but it seems that the smaller class have more bubbles in it, definitely. And then I looked into shape parameters to see if they are the same bubbles, if they are all the same shapes. And you can see that the shape parameters here for the finer class are different. They show more complex shapes and more elongated, a little bit more elongation in it. If you look into the same graphs for all the three different deposits, you see that the cores of the more magmatic seems to have only one nucleation event, like this peak, and the dry phreatic magmatic ones seem to have like a more continuous nucleation, and the wet phreatic magmatic show this too, but they have this low in here, which you could interpret it as due to coalescence. And that shows a lot quite nicely here as well in the shape parameters. So my preliminary interpretations, because I'm still working on, is that for the finer grains, is that they have a higher bubble number densities than the coarse grains, is that we seem to have like heterogeneous physical distribution in the magma before fragmentation. So you get more vesicular parts, and they seem to break into finer pieces. So these more vesicular parts seem to have also like continuous nucleation, and the shape parameters indicate like a higher degree of coalescence, and I think that is not due to travel magma rise speed, but it's more due to you have a higher likelihood of bubbles to meet each other if you have more bubbles in the magma. And less vesicular parts show like bubble size distributions typical for one nucleation event, and so a small degree of coalescence. And it seems that these parts are not actively degassing. So it seems that the gas goes in certain parts, arises through the magma there, and other parts seem to have like an older nucleation event, but then there's not active degassing anymore. So then the interpretation of the different facets types is that the phreatic magmatic samples show more homogeneous vesiculation and continuous nucleation, and with this assumption that the coalescence is due to high bubble number density. And so we think that these that the phreatic magmatic samples are due to higher maybe the magma rise rate was higher in these for these samples, and the more magmatic samples show like heterogeneous vesiculation and gas travel paths, so it seems that they are maybe a little bit slower in the magma rise speed, and they have different rise speeds in different parts of the conduit. And I was very quick. That's it.
Thank you. It's time for questions. I have one as well. Do you have any control on how closely in time the different eruption styles might have been spaced?
But in the stratigraphy?
Yes.
No, not really, but I think it's... I think that the whole eruption, there are no breaks in there. We can't find any breaks, so it might be in a few days or like in a few weeks. I can't say that really. I can't close. But they are on top of each other, so you see like sharp break and then the next one.
So it's a sudden break.
Yeah.
Not a gradational.
No.
So my question, maybe I might skip that. Do you have an estimate of the volume of these eruptions? And if you can tell us about the tectonics in that area, because you have this large MAR, and I mean 3 kilometers. I mean, people might start thinking about calderas and.
The tectonics in that area is you have these. Can I go back?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Maybe to one of the first slides. Yeah, so you see in red is the Neovolcanics province, the purple is the Paleozoic basement, and the the Otway Basin was formed due to the breakup of Gondwana, so you have all these fault lines in it. And we actually find that Parambit is located on one of the major fault lines, which are from, but not from the breakup, they are from the, this fault line is from the Paleozoic basement. But it seems that there's a second fault going through as well. So yeah, it seems that it is located on that. But we think that these large size of the mare is due to more multiple vent locations in the mare itself. But the question is, why is it then so round, and why do you not see more like lobes in it? That's something I'm still working on.
Anything on the volume?
Well, the volume is I haven't. Well, the volume of I only showed the volume of the deposits I could map on the field, which is around 0.25 cubic kilometers. But I find that a lot of fine ash is missing in it, so I think the volume was quite, like, way larger than that.
Thank you. Final chance. If not, we thank all our speakers, and we thank all of you for sticking around with us on Friday afternoon. It was a pleasure to have you here. Thank you very much.